Senzeni na.
Senzeni na.
Tina.
Today is the day black people were fighting for their freedom to learn in their home languages.
It was when our rights was infringed of what says of our right to choice, when we were not able to choose what home language you're supposed to learn in schools. We enforced languages of Afrikaans and Isis, but mostly Afrikaans. We're not allowed to choose between both of them.
Youth Day is the day where we celebrate the youth of South Africa.
It's whereby people in South Africa celebrate it because of what happened in 1973 or 1974, I'm not sure.
Black learners or children were protesting to learn in their home languages, African languages.
Students were fighting for lesser school fees. Why? Maybe because of poverty at that time, where they didn't have money to pay for the school fees.
Hector was a young boy who was shot during the riots in 1973 or 1974. I'm not sure what the years. Yeah, and he was shot and he died in this other young boy's head.
He was an activist, was shot during the protest time on the 16th of June.
He was one of the school learners that fought in Soweto for learners to have freedom of speech.
He was shot when he was fighting for the right of choice, right of choosing our subjects.
What is your language of instruction here at school?
Oh, it's Zulu.
We use Afrikaans, English and Zulu, but you only get two choices, which English is compulsory. And I'm happy about it because this was my choice. Afrikaans was my choice. And I don't see anything wrong with Afrikaans.
I don't like the subject. I don't have to lie. I wish English was just the only language.
I don't see a reason why it should be, because there are people who know how to speak Afrikaans fluently, but I believe like it should be removed in the schooling system per se, because there are some students who learn our languages, but and we are forced to learn their language. I don't celebrate Youth Day. I've never celebrated Youth Day.
Why not?
I don't know how to celebrate it. That's the thing. But I see people wearing school uniforms to celebrate it. That's another way. But I really don't know how to celebrate it, and no one in my family has ever celebrated it before.
No, I don't.
Why?
I think since, in my point of view, people are still oppressed in other areas, but they are not recognized.
What do you mean by being oppressed?
They are still forced. There are schools who are still forcing people to do Afrikaans as their home languages. Yeah.
Yes, I do, because it emphasizes on the changes of how it has changed our system in this 21st century that we end.
I really do not know much about it, and I don't see any importance of Youth Day.
Fees was followed well by the tertiary students were striking for high education fees to be dropped, if it's the right word to say. Yeah.
Do you know ANC Youth League president?
Yes.
What's his name?
Cyril Ramaphosa, I think.
I'm not sure. I don't follow politics.
I do not know.
Sono Seto, Bubumia, Sono Seto.
My political career is very fascinating. I don't know if it's fascinating, but I think it's very fascinating because I started my political career, I was in high school, so here's a fascinating part, is that I was in grade 8, I was politically in CHU as well, but when I was in grade 9, you know what is called the prefect. I had ambitions to become the LRC president. They don't call the SRC, they call it Learners Representative Council. So I had ambitions to become the president of LRC, and I tried to be class rep in grade 9. Unfortunately, didn't succeed, and then I became the additional member of the LRC. When I went to grade 10, I tried again. It didn't go well. And then in grade 12 again, I tried, and then I became the LRC president of my school, finally, since grade 9. Going back, when I was in grade 9, I started what is called Congress of South African Students in my high school, which is COSAS, which is the student learners organization aligned with the African National Congress, ANC. I came to university. The first thing I did, because I'm from COSAS, I understand politics, I have to join the SASCO, which is called Congress, South African Congress of Students. And it's where I cut it my teeth as well in terms of student politics.
Well, my political career as a career started effectively in 2014. I was first year adverts, but like the EFF adverts at the time was a very powerful space of ideas and of changing the lives of young people. Fortunately, I was one of the lucky people to have been baptized by the fire under the chairmanship of the newly sworn in parliamentarian chairman Vuyani Pambo. And like that was a very memorable time. I was elected as a treasurer of his executive, and like it has been a learning journey ever since.
One of the things that really I can say pushed me to join politics, I read the book which is called the Nelson Mandela book, the Long Walk to Freedom, and I read the book and I got much interest about Nelson Mandela's life and his politics. There's no politics first initial I was introduced to except the ANC.
I think I joined EFF instinctively before the EFF was formed, because the EFF, in as much as we might want to deny, you know, our association with the ANC, is a product of policy work of the ANC Youth League under the leadership of Julius Malema, Nico Shivambu, and Sindiso Makaka, the collective, you know. At that time, when those policies were being articulated, I started having an interest in politics, because they were speaking about, you know, expropriation of land. I was learning these new concepts. You know, what does the nationalization mean? You know, why do white people fear these things? And at that time, of course, I was attracted to anything that strikes fear in the hearts of white people, because that is what they have been to me, you know. So I found a voice, 2011, to stand up for myself. I was in high school. This was when Julius Malema, you know, was controversial for, you know, dealing with whiteness and the entitlement of white, you know, privilege. And it gave me sort of a voice. But formally, I think it was 2014 when I arrived to VETS. It was after registration, orientation week.
June 16 is significant for the young people. Because to me, it's a mark, you know, it's a mark of the struggle. It's part of the struggle of that led to our liberation. And for the student to sacrifice whatever they've sacrificed, you know, that is that history, we can't take it for granted. Despite the life being lost, but at the same time, we can't take for granted the history itself, the body of history, the language, and the symbolism that it portrays in the history of the June 6th, the history that was made by the young people, the history that was made by the conscious and brave young people to take to the street to say, we want this liberation, we can't compromise, We're fighting the regime. There's a regime. Our life matters, but as well, we can throw our bodies in for us to get liberation.
June 16 will remain significant. Years to come, you know, it marks a turning point in history, because for the first time in history, June 16, this was South Africa at a time where young people decided to organize themselves and to take to the streets, you know, to go out and demonstrate their political aspirations. They rejected a system that was meant, you know, to make them permanent slaves in their economy. And it's still significant, moreover, because 25 years after the democratic dispensation, you still find more or less the same problems with the education system, still find more or less the same problem of racism in South Africa, even though they try to mask it and cover it up. But you can see that the poor are black and the white are rich. You know, and it shows that, you know, the apartheid spatial planning, you know, the distribution of wealth in the country, the ownership of the means of production, these are all in white hands. You know, the ownership of the land, these are in white hands, and there's nothing much different. So June 16 serves as a reminder that young people stood up one day and died, you know, for this idea of like a education which is meant for the people, which has an agenda of transforming society. Because them rejecting Bantu education was not just because Bantu education was Afrikaans.
The significance itself of history doesn't end there, but it ends in terms of defending that history that happened, to say, as a young people, I don't want to see the reversal of the history. I don't want to see that disposition that happened with me as myself, as a black person who's not allowed to stay in my country. I don't want to see that disposition that happened with me as a human being itself, that was not given civil right, that was not given the Bill of Rights. I was more as a black person insignificant compared to the white person counterpart. And why was that important for the June 16 to fight, and so far as it concerned? They were defending first, they were defending their identity. We know that the white people, the white supremacist Afrikaner people wanted to introduce their curriculum in high school, which was wanted black people to learn about their language. So cultural, they were trying to create a cultural domination as a sort of a hegemony, trying to infiltrate the interests of the black people by hegemonizing their cultural language and making us to adopt their language.
It also shows that people were willing to die, you know, for an idea in which they believe.
June 16 is one of the part of the parcel that contributed to the culmination of the liberation of South Africa. That's one of the important things. Second, June 16 is that symbolism, is a defense and against the history that happened. You see, we have stand against this thing. We have stood against the oppression of the black people. We have stood against the oppression of those who were defined as the Arab compared to the compared to the European ones, and the people who were conquered by the colonization. So by putting this history together and say we're going to defend it, not happen again. So that's very important for me. That's why June 16 is still important. And as well, the fact that it was a youth struggle, it shows that the consciousness and the burning consciousness and the bravery of those young people, we still need to honor them.
Bantu education is a system that is meant to keep the black person in their place and to make out of, so the best you can be out of Bantu education is a good servant, you know. You can say yes, boss. And even you go to university, you're going to say yes, boss in a different way. You'll just be wearing a tie, you know, and you'll be writing in a laptop. But you're saying yes, boss, at the end of the day. And June 16 reminds us that Bantu education is not dead, that apartheid is not dead.
It was the education that was made to serve the white man and was made as a way to internalize the subordination of the black man or a black woman, any form of internalizing the inferiority complex to the black people, to say, those who understand will know the Vude said that there's no need for black child to learn about the mathematics in school and science, because they will never use that in the society applied. So Bantu education was to take away the skills from black people, was a way to take the talent from black people, was a way to take the imagination within the black people, was the way to take a creativity within the black community. And all of this was made in order for for the African to disarm the black child of all of these things that I've mentioned, imaginative, creativity, and as well as intellectual property that was supposed to be owned by the black people. So the Afrikaner, by introducing that kind of bantu education, was made for that. And it did a lot of, if you have seen, it did a lot of consequences. It can even go to the budget in terms of how many, how, like, we know that black child has allocated very little budget, to the point that that's why some of them couldn't even afford to go to school. In that particular time, we have a lot of illiterate community today of our grandmothers and our mothers, and that is a consequence of that particular, of those particular days.
What do you think are the similarities between the Fees Must Fall and the Soweto Uprising?
Fees Must Fall movement and the Soweto Uprising both problematize the question of language, right? The question of language, not only as like a means of communication, but also language as a means of instilling a particular idea of dominance, right? White people are entitled. In the school that I went to, it was a world school. White people, they used to write maths on this one board, and they'd write Vaskanda on the other board. And it even delayed us, but they were prepared to have our academic calendar being delayed by them trying to balance the dual sort of system of teaching. You know, you get to universities in UP, you know, there's residences that are reserved particularly for African speaking people. You know, there's universities where you find that there's an exam paper that is written in Afrikaans. You know, there's never been a convenience of us writing our papers in university in Setswana or Sexhosa, isiZulu, you know, Sepedi, Tonga, and all those things.
It's the lack of coherent plan and strategy. June 16, we know that it didn't have a strategy and coherent plan of action. Those who have engaged with the material of Achimafeje 1978, called the aftermath of 1976. Achimafeje was an anthropologist at UCT, and he was debating with Rootfest. Rootfest was an activist, a young Communist League secretary for the country, female, brilliant. And one of the things that Achimafeje have pointed out was that June 16 lacks strategy and tactics and coherent plan of action. When you come back to the Fees Must Fall, it's the same thing. We didn't have a strategy and tactics. We didn't have a coherent plan of action to combat what is the core problem of the education system. So we, most of us, let me say, brought struggle of the Fees Must Fall. It ended up thinking that the issue of free education, cut across was a solution for everything that we want to get in the universities. But we can see that that was just a tip in the water, the drop of water, because as much as we fought for free education, there's only 900,000, close between 500,000 to 900,000 young people in the university spaces. But there are 15 million young people outside the universities who didn't qualify to come to university. Some who didn't even can't come to university because of the financial crisis, including as well the geographical spatial that was made by the apartheid. So for us as well to say we're fighting for free education was I always say it's a historical victory for the youth of South Africa to have gotten the free education, as much as not fully free education. But at the same time, there are still 15 young people outside who can't come to the universities. Only less than 1 million people were in the university spaces. So we have a proper plan of action and a coherent plan and digest in terms of what is the problem here, not only to concern Fees Must Fall only with us people in the universities, but cut across every young people, every young person in South Africa.
Both these movements question the role and purpose of education, you know, because you have Bantu education that says we want education that will liberate us, right? And we're willing to not go to school because what we're being taught is to be slaves. We want an education that empowers us. And you would, if you go to the archives, you'd find a video of Tsietse Mashini articulating the very same positions, that ideas like communism, socialism, you know, Marxism, as it were, are ideas that were not taught here, you know, progressive ideas. Not to say that these are innocent ideas or ideas that have our interest in heart, but to say that these are ideas that were, you know, were limited access to, particularly because it did not serve the cause of the racist and capitalist agenda of South Africa. Fees Must Fall also was like a moment of impatience, just as much as June 16 was a moment of impatience, because you're saying enough is enough. We are the ones sleeping in the libraries. We are the ones, you know, going to class without having eaten anything. We're sleeping in the computer labs or squatting with one another. It disturbs our studies. It disturbs our mental stability. It disturbs also like us, our social experience, you know, of university, because the social experience is just as important as the academic one. And we were saying we're tired of having to come here in January. They turn you back because you don't have the 10,000 rand to register, or they financially exclude you in June because you have not paid a single cent, right? Not that they don't know that you are poor, but they want you to prove each and every year, year in, year out, that your mother is dead if your mother is dead, that your mother is poor if your mother is poor. Reminders, constant reminders that, look, you are at the receiving end, you should know your place in this university. And you find that most of us that are in the universities that have sort of participated in the movement of Fees Must Fall over the past 5 years have been pushed one way or the other. It's either they came at you because you owe the university, or came at you because they started suspending you and your academics were compromised. You know, it's always a system of trying to victimize and remind us that, look, you comrades here, we're doing you a favor.
Do you think the state of campuses in terms of accommodation, food and textbook, do we have enough?
No. It is not changed, and it's never going to change before the government takes a decisive position, you know, because you'd find we protest as the current generation of university students. We protest, we want accommodation. Let's say maybe the government gives us a building. But because most of us are graduating, in the next 2 years the building is no longer there and the students are back at square one. You know, the accommodation crisis is not dealt with because the government has not intervened. The university is not willing to, actually they keep on taking the prices up. And you find that individuals that are in provincial government of Gauteng, for example, are in cohorts and are investing in companies of individuals and private property owners like South Point. You know, South Point is a monopoly in Bramfontein, right? We find that PIC is a majority shareholder in South Point. So our government gives us NSFAS as a loan on one hand and takes it back, you know, through expensive pricing of the companies of student accommodation they invest in. Where else this company is supposed to be cheaper and a cheaper alternative out competing mm-hmm. other private companies? Mm-hmm. It's actually the company that is now becoming a monopoly and benefiting out of the situation of there's not enough accommodation. So you find that that situation has not changed. But the situation also, food security is a crisis in other campuses. And it now becomes on the student leader, you know, whether you're SASC or EFF, it becomes on you. It does not become the responsibility of government. It does not become the responsibility of the university that you eat. It's initiatives from comrades, and it takes away time from our studies when you try to do something for our fellow students. As student leaders, we end up finding ourselves that our mental health is compromised. Some of our people commit suicide, you know what I'm saying? Because they are dealing with problems, and their problems are piling up while they're doing it.
Accommodation is a crisis. It continues to be a crisis to our universities. Early this year, we dealt with a lot of crisis of the accommodation. We had like more than 500 students who didn't have accommodation. Completely didn't have accommodation, homeless. Let alone the student who had funding and accommodation. Those who didn't have accommodation had funding. More than 500 students, we managed at University through the SLC to accommodate more than half of that. We managed to get 5 buildings from the provincial government. So the accommodation is going to be a crisis going forward, it's going to be completely a crisis. Even though we tried this year to do it, we saw, I'm sure those who were following us, we did perform the hunger strike. Even people were saying, you know, why are you doing the hunger strike? But we believe that through the hunger strike, we can raise the consciousness and awareness to the people. And there's people who know that the Tiananmen Square of 1989 in China was hunger strike by the student to fight for democratic system. to be incorporated to the socialist system of China. But as well, with us, with the hunger strike, we managed to achieve some of the things. But we know that next year, I know for the fact that next year, I'm the secretary of the SRC, I know for the fact that next year, there will be a huge problem. There will be a huge problem if they don't remove this backlog of accommodation crisis. There will be a huge number of children who won't have accommodation. There will be a huge number of children who can't afford accommodation. We went to the meeting with the vice chancellor of people. We told him, why don't you buy this building? He told us it's going to cost more than 500 billion. They don't have that kind of a budget to buy buildings at Brown. So this is one of the ways that I'm telling you that we're still going to face a huge problem. There's a lot of shortage of food. There's a report that was released last year. I just forgot, but it was a colloquium that was organized by a national, one of the research funding. It released a report at Cape Town, it was curriculum, and one of the main reasons was saying that the universities are one of the most of the hungry site, you know, and that research portrays that community, society outside universities, as much as the number of people are hungry, but university have a large number of people are hungry. So I'll give you an example. At university, what you call WCCO, which they help with food and all of this kind of thing for students who don't have food. And if you can check with their number and data, I was showing last year that there's only 2,000 people in West only depend on them for their food. Cape Town, UJ, I think, is the most campus where there's hunger in regard to the student. Within the report that was released by that institute at Cape Town, UCT, a colloquium. So there's a huge backlog of food security within the universities.
We find that, you know, there's a problem generally of collusive pricing, for example, right? People that government schools, for example, buy food for feeding schemes, right? Those people participate in collusive practices, and they sort of do price fixing to make food more expensive. They do the same with uniform, you know. They are so invested and so obsessed about the idea of commodifying education that learning equipment becomes expensive. You know, the computers, the textbooks, you know, the uniform for primary and high school children. It becomes expensive and more unaffordable, because as prices are going up, salaries of our mothers are not going equivalently up, you know. They have to deal with petrol, they have to deal with the price of bread that is going up. They have to deal with the fact that they are raising they have the whole family on their shoulders. Even if you work or I work, we'll probably have some responsibility in our family of, you know, taking care of someone who's not even directly your son, but because of black families and we have a sort of societal approach, collective nature, we will assist there and there. And these things are not factored in our experience as the students. And hence I'm saying nothing has changed, you know, compared to 2014 when he first made the cry for FISMA's fall. NSFAS is still insufficient, but they're still insisting on keeping NSFAS there. You know, we invested in projects of trying to get actuarial scientists to come and help us design a model of how the government can fund free education. Like from the aspect of registration to textbooks to paying the lecturers and accommodation all together. We tried and participated in those exercises, but the government rejected us.
To what extent do you think FISMA's fall helped students? It can be your first year, second year, but how do you think it helped them in terms of fees?
It's a victory. FISMA's fall was a victory. That is undeniable. FISMA's fall was a historic victory. And it did help a lot of students in terms of fees, in terms of... because when our first year, it's a grant, you don't have to pay it back.
One of the things that I can say we achieved was firstly to open a conversation and to start a discourse, you know, on not only the education sector but other sectors as well, because they became more of a hands-on interrogative approach, but also, you know, to create a generation. I believe that anyone who was a part of the FISMA's fall generation and has graduated into the workplace has some of those politics in them, you know, and they will try, by all means, and I mean, that you are covering this as someone who was part of the FISMA's Fall movement says a lot, you know, that you don't want the book to be closed on the conversation when the views have not been totally captured. You want the story of FISMA's Fall to be told properly and justly. That for me is enough evidence. The legal practitioners, I have confidence that they're doing it, even though there's not a lot of them. You know, the medical practitioners as well. People go into their workplace as changed individuals, and at least we're able to do that. But unfortunately, you know, registration is still an issue. We hope that the EFF will go to Parliament and fight for that vigorously, so that across the board there is no registration fee. Mm-hmm. You come to school with either your academic transcript from the previous year, or you come with your matric certificate to say that I matriculated, here's my application, please can you register me, you understand? As opposed to you now, you have to wait in that long line with your mother's, you know, affidavit that she doesn't work. That is humiliating, to say the least, because while you're doing that, you can see the white kids, you know, the Indian kids, they're enjoying life, they're driving their first cars, a car that your father will never drive in first year. You know, and you just see that things have not changed, you know. They used to use race to close black kids out of Vets University, but today they use money. We want a system that your kid and my kid will be able to benefit from. They must not pay a single cent from accommodation to tuition to food, you know. Mm-hmm. They must not suffer. Just that you qualify is enough for you to be at school and to get a degree. And these degrees are not for us to go and floss in the townships for our unemployed brothers. These are weapons to fight in a greater battle of liberating our country and of changing. You know, we can contribute in different ways in the struggle. I, for one, you know, I know that if there's not school, there's music at which I can try to contribute to the cause. There's journalism that you are using to fight your cause and to sort of advocate and paint a different picture and tell a different story, you know? Mm-hmm. Let us all contribute. Bumlungisi Madonsela and DUT, they were killed in protests. They did not die in vain, you know? Bukhanya Gcekeshe were incarcerated. Bumcebo Dlamini was still facing trial. Bubunkosi, you know, Bubunkosi Kanyile, who are still under house arrest. You know, all those people, their efforts are not in vain, so we need to rise up to say that, comrades, we acknowledge your battling and thank you. Let's keep pushing.
I want you to explain for me in simple terms, what is free decolonized education?
Free decolonized education is, well, the correct term is free quality, you know, decolonized education. It's an education system that is decommodified one, that does not need any money for you to get through it, for you to get access to it. But it's an accessible education as well. It's an education also which has an agenda, you know, of whiting or wiping out the stereotypes that have characterized our society, the racist, capitalist, you know, anti-poor, anti-black stereotypes that have been in our syllabus. The overarching supervision of whiteness in the academic system, we want to wipe it away, and it must turn the system from an education which takes the student and produces a graduate, which is going to be a functionary of capitalism and white racism, to transforming a system into being a system that just benefits and contributes to a nation-building agenda of eradicating poverty, of ending inequality.
I always tell one of my counterparts, especially from the EFF and PASMA, who advocate for decolonization of education, that these things that we're advocating for, especially decolonization of education, you don't need to create slogans for it and leave them there. I use the analogy of called Nongawusa to say our people during those time of colonization, they made a bad mistake, a blindfold of Nongawusa. Everything, you know the story of Nongawusa, what happened, and how the Xhosa people end up destroying what was their livestock and the means of production, productive factors. Thinking that by destroying the plow, killing their animal, cows and everything, the ancestors are going to rise, they're going to resurrect and throw away the settlers. And it didn't happen. It's the same thing now. We think as a student, most of the students, that by chanting decolonization education, you'll something is going to rise out of that, and it's going to throw away the most of the Euro-American modernity curriculum, which is not the case. In order for me to advocate for decolonization, I need to do PhD, I need to do masters, I need to go back and lecture. And then those research people are doing about this kind of thing, I must be responsible in making sure those things they don't gather dust in the libraries. I must use those things as a part of the content of the course. I must write about these kind of things. I need to write about the living experience. Some of them they call the ontological aspect of black people's life. I need to write about these things. So the curriculum, in order for it to feature this kind of different aspect of life, including the black people experience, is my responsibility as well. But that won't happen by me chanting in the street and leaving university. Like, I need to be there.
Do you think there's access to quality education?
Well, access is for the rich. So there is no access, I would say. Access is for the rich. The poor don't have access at all, and the poor are the majority. And this is why I would move with the view of the majority, that there's no access to higher education. Not unless you're connected, not unless you have money.
That is sad. Even if there's free education, that will remain a myth. And you know the myth is a depoliticization of a political statement, in this sense. You're depoliticizing the political statement. So by virtue of saying that we have free education, we'll have a youth problem being resolved. That is what depoliticization of challenges that youth is facing in the communities, challenge of unemployment, inequality, and poverty. So I would say that university will never be a solution. It is a solution for some, like they are very sectorial space, right? And I think that for the university to be a solution, wouldn't have 15 million young people languishing in poverty outside unemployment, and with only 500,000 people, 900,000 young people in the university spaces. And now we have seen as well, even the unemployment is a challenge for even those who went to university, not only those who didn't go to university.
The Youth League is no longer the Youth League of Robert Sobukwe, you know, where they used to say, no, we don't want this reformist approach, we want the pro-black Africanist approach. It's been surrendered, you know, to the highest bidder, where leaders of the ANC use the ANC Youth League to fight their own personal battles, as opposed to it being a weapon to fight struggles of the youth. Colin Maine, I'm yet to hear of a struggle as champion, as the president, you know. Julius, as COSA's president, you championed corporal punishment like nobody's business. You know, he pronounced the one computer, one student program, which they are still struggling with in SASCO. It's mere rhetoric there. You know, he has not championed anything. Unemployment question, he has not said anything. He has not said anything about substance abuse. He has not said anything about, you know, the general problem of youth being idle in our country.
There's a gap. There's a huge gap in terms of youth representation. And the Youth League is missing in the game. It's not there. And I wrote even an article in 2016 to say they are not representing the young people in so far as to inspire what the generation of June 16 have been done. And I would say even today to say that gap needs to be filled. The rise of Islam must fall and road must fall. Just didn't fall from the believing, didn't come from the sky. It is a material condition that have necessitated that kind of a strive. But the bad thing with it, as I've told you, that it lacked strategy, tactics, and coherence of action. And one of the things that it lacked it within it, that broader strike of the Fisherman's Fall, that I remember during the when we go to Union Building, that was a march. I can say one of my friends even say that was a march. I won't say it's the first march, but I think it's one of the first matches that we went there, and then we left without being addressed by anyone. We went there creating the memorandum. No one took anything. The way that was altered was a weight by the person who's supposed to be the program director. But other than that, no one has spoken to anyone. No leader has taken this thing. So there's a lack of leadership within that space. that can combine and collectively student leadership. In the union building, yes, we do have different leaders. We did have Nompendu, Dlamini, Vuyani, Shaira, different people. But at the time, the contestation and contingency that was happening there, it was not allowing the material condition. The two students said, no, we can't address by these people. Tevlop said, no, we don't want to be addressed by Vetsi. They were rejecting. But because of the lack of that umbrella body that's supposed to be carrying and encompassing the collective aspiration of the young people, that was not there to guide. That is what led to us being, even at some point, making coherent plan moving forward.
It's an insult to young people because, you know, to have a president who is a stooge and a mere puppet, you know, of bigger sort of cabals in the ANC, it's an insult to young people. And that is the ANC Youth League, makes it more even disappointing, because the Youth League was formed by Bumda, you know, and Anton Lembed. You know, and that generation brought and introduced itself as sort of a whipper, not harsh one, but a whipper to the agenda and policy direction of the organization, which is the ANC. Can I take this call?
Yes,
we need to revive the Youth League, and one of the things to revive the Youth League, I think they need to, ANC need to disband the Youth League. We've been protesting. After here, I'm going to the protest at Kandi Square in Gauteng now, that the ANC Youth League need to be disbanded, to be dissolved. Because one, the ANC Youth League leaders, they are not the ANC Youth League members. By virtue of being 35, above 35, you cease to be the ANC Youth League member through the framework of the constitution of the ANC Youth League. So what does it mean? It entails that the ANC Youth League leaders are not ANC Youth League members to start with. Before we go to the point of saying the ANC Youth League leaders, because they didn't meet the category and the classification to say, during this time you need to go to the Congress and have new leadership, they cease to be a legitimate structure. So the ANC Youth League body is not existing here. And we're saying they need to, the ANC need to disband them and take very vibrant, agile young people to run the structure.
I just want to say that we should have a happy youth day.